2 of the 888.com World Grand Prix. Well, it's a very special day. It's St. Patrick's Day. The Irish are having fun over there, but all the action's taking place right in there. Who's going to have the luck of the Irish? Let's find out.
This song is called The Luck of the Irish.
You never know. You never know. There's six pockets on the table. There's six pockets on the table.
Well, on break off now, I'm delighted to say that the event manager, Donna Watkins, has joined us. Donna, just a very, very quick one, really, because this is day two of, and how was yesterday?
Fans in particular and the crowds have been really good, especially yesterday, day one. Obviously, a Monday, not always the easiest sessions to fill on a Monday afternoon, but we've had some really great walk-ups from the venue, really great, good local support from not just public, but also local businesses and supported sort of council affiliates and things like that as well. So great walk-up, great crowds, and the players themselves seem really happy with it. Great conditions, obviously some great results of some of our boys yesterday, and the tables themselves, we've had some rave reviews about how they're performing with the conditions here. So all good from everybody involved.
Donna, thanks. And talking of tables, we caught up with the man in charge, the table fitter himself. We're into revealing secrets and things that you don't normally see, and I would suggest that one of the most important issues of this entire snooker tournament relies solely on this table. This table is elegant, wonderful, and every player so far has told me that it plays brilliantly, and it's all down to this man here. Here's our table fitter. Well, so congratulations firstly on getting sort of 10 out of 10 from every player. But it's not as easy as that, is it? I mean, how long does this take from start to finish?
Well, we came in here on the Saturday morning to install the two arena tables, two practice and a cue zone. And we didn't finish until late Sunday, really, Sunday afternoon.
So it's a whole 24 hours?
Oh, at least, yeah. It depends what problems you get on the floors and what the carpet's like, but...
So just tell us a couple of little secrets that the general public won't know. What sort of skill is required and what sort of tools do you use?
A lot of people think it's we just sort of use modern tools, but we use old braces. We've got magnetic hammers, which is probably about the most modern tool we use with drills. But we've got old spirit levels, old engineer spirit levels. I mean, some of them are about 150 quid second hand, but they're accurate to a thou per foot. Rather than people thinking that we just basically use a long 12-foot level with a bubble in a minute in the middle of it, and then that's it. But no, it's a lot. We try and bring as much modern technology in, but you can't. It's just an old craft that's always pretty much going to stay the same.
And so it's built up on a slate bed. And how many slates make up a full-size table?
There's five slates on there, all weighing 200 kilos a piece. So you've literally got a ton of slate on it. So the total weight of a table is about a ton and a half.
So if me and you wanted to push it an inch that way, forget it. We couldn't do it.
It's doable, but I don't want to do it.
Interesting thing about the pockets, everybody, is that what you don't or might not know, and if you can come round this side a little bit, you'll get to see it, there's a camera built inside the pocket. How much does that interfere with the play? Or if it doesn't interfere with the play, how much does it interfere with your fitting?
None at all, really. I mean, we basically get the table finished, and then they come in, they turn up, they carry the cameras themselves, and they turn up, we just fit them. And then there may be one or two tweaks just to adjust the height of the back of the plate, just to make sure it's, you know, nice and flat. But it doesn't interfere with us, and the players, it's nothing, really. They just get on with it.
And how do you feel about being the most important man in the building?
I wouldn't say on that. I think that's Ronnie O'Sullivan. Normally, isn't it? It's all about him, not me.
It's all about him. Interesting stuff there from the table fitter, who will in fact be the busiest man in town this weekend. On Wednesday will be our final two table scenario. Friday, four quarterfinals. Saturday, the two semis. And on Sunday, the grand final. It'll all be down to one table. He certainly will be the busiest man in town. It's St. Patrick's Day here in Llandudno, and we thought we'd have the St. Paddy's Day challenge. Look at this. Break off. It's St. Patrick's Day. This is the Irish Challenge. We are about to show you, Ben, very famous Irish people. You're going to tell us who they are. See how many you can get in 20 seconds. Good luck.
Pierce Brosnan. Bewitched. Bob Geldof. No idea. Oh, I know him. Oh. Oh, she goes out with Frank Lampard.
Yes or no?
No, yeah.
All done, time's up.
Don't laugh. Some very, very famous Irish people. And you will tell me who they are. You've got 20 seconds. Good luck.
Colin Farrell. Oh, presenter. Oh, oh, pass. Dara O'Brien. God, I'm blank. Oh my God, what's his name?
Pass.
Oh, I can't. Kevin Norton. Norton. Graham Norton. Jed Wood. Liam Neeson. That's it already.
I'm about to show Mark Selby some very famous Irish people. He will tell me who they are. He has 20 seconds and my money's on you. Stand by. Here we go.
Now.
Louis Walsh. Nadine Coyle. Ronan Keaton. Roy Walker. Terry Wogan. The Cause. You two. Pierce Brosnan. Is that? Ah. I know who it is.
Well, it looks like the number one, Mark Selby, certainly knows his Irish history. He goes into the lead. But there's plenty more on our St. Paddy's Day challenge coming up later on all our social media outlets. Well, the afternoon's play. Joe Perry went through. Incredible. He was our first player to win this afternoon. And then it was the turn of Peter Ebden. He was, in fact, the match of the day. 4-3 winner over Sean Murphy. And this is what he had to say. 3-2 up. The Brown. And it all turned the game a little bit. You really had to dig deep and come back with a 1-3-6 to win it. I mean, you must be absolutely thrilled. Where's the motivation for that?
Well, to be honest, the motivation for me today in winning this match was the fact that I couldn't be there with my children in Dubai. They are in a school play, a performance tonight in Dubai, and they've been rehearsing and preparing for this for over 3 months now. So, you know, I really, really wanted to be there. But, you know, this is such a great opportunity to play against the top players. You know, I hope they understand.
Peter Ebden through to the next round. Joined by Ivan, and it won't be the same unless us two are discussing and dissecting the afternoon's play. We had an incredible afternoon on day two, didn't we? But I think really and truthfully, the match of the afternoon was Peter Ebden's 4-3 win over Sean Murphy. Wasn't that a barn burner?
It was really exciting, and the crowd here in Llandudno, which was a really, really good audience, really got their money's worth with that one. I thought when Ebden missed the Brown, when he had a chance to win 4-2 in the sixth frame, Murphy cleared up from brown to black. I couldn't see Ebden winning at that point. I thought Murphy would go on and win, but what a break that was from Ebden in the final frame. 1-3-6, really showed his class. He's 44 years old now, but he's showed that he can still produce the goods when it matters. He's had a pretty good season, actually. He's kind of on the fringes of the top 32, but he's trying to climb back up there towards the top 16. He doesn't normally like the best of sevens. He prefers the longer format, but that result today will give him a massive boost.
True words. And Ricky Waldron continued the ding bashing that we've seen in recent months. Ding Junhui just can't do it. I just lack of confidence. What is it?
It's unbelievable. I mean, he won 5 ranking events last season, the best season of his career. For some reason this season, he just can't do it. He keeps losing in the first round. You know, like you say, I think his confidence is rock bottom. I think he's getting frustrated. I think he feels that players are maybe rating their game a little bit against him. But, you know, we saw after the match when he came up here, he was obviously like really upset. He left the venue straight away. He maybe just needs one or two results to turn things around. He's still got the class. He's still got the technique. Who knows? Maybe he'll win the World Championship. You know, he's got a very poor record at the Crucible, but maybe after such a quiet season, he'll surprise everyone.
And finally, Mark Davis beat Marco Fu.
Yeah, Fu was favourite for that match, especially as Davis hasn't had the best season so far, but he had back-to-back centuries today, played really well.
Right then, from all of us on day two in the afternoon session, for more of Breakoff, make sure you join us tomorrow. Bye for now.